Hello. Good morning. Good to see y'all this morning. Y'all. Yeah.
She's been in Indiana going down south.
Yeah, going down south. Yeah. Anyway, thank you, Amanda, for filling in. Appreciate you so much. Yes, let's give her a hand. Pastor leaves on vacation. He hopes by noon tomorrow. Any bets? Pastor leaves for vacation tomorrow, and he's hopefully out of here by noon. Mm-hmm. You think you're going to make it?
Oh, Lucy, I don't know.
Lucy's got to do laundry yet. Pack her bag. Oh, that's done? Okay. All right. Blair has an announcement.
Two announcements, actually.
Two of them.
So you may have heard that Bob is stepping down from the One Call Now ministry. Where's Mindy? Mindy, can you stand up, please? Yes. Yay. So introducing Mindy Poe.
Come on up, everybody.
So this is Mindy Poe. She has volunteered to chair this ministry. I may or may not have had Amanda count the number of days between the first One Call Now message in 2009 and now, 5,284 days.
Wow.
How many messages do you think were delivered between now and then? I counted them all. 2,504.
Wow.
That is one message every 2.1 days.
Oh.
So that means if you spent 1 minute calling every person manually, it would take you 117 days nonstop, no sleep.
Oh, boy.
But we don't expect you to do that.
Are you ready to quit before you start?
No. Nope. I got this, guys.
Good.
Would you like to share your phone number?
Yes. My phone number is 989.
It's in the bulletin.
Okay.
472-7588.
Yeah.
And sorry, if anybody needs it again, you know, you can always come to me. It's 989-472-7588.
That's all right.
That's not the number in the bulletin. You put our phone number in there in the bulletin. Oh, no.
I'm glad you heard me say it.
That's
right
under me.
That's
right under
me.
It's in there.
It's in there.
It's in there.
Oh, yeah.
It's in there.
Look what I have to live with.
You may want to leave before noon tomorrow. Thank you, Mindy.
You might want to leave right now.
We have another interesting announcement. Some of us have actually been attending church here for quite some time. Amanda, stand up, please. Diane, who else has been here since 2008? Anybody else? I know Judy Dearman is not here today. Judith Sandifer is not here today. That's around the time we started our Compassionate Ministry food program. And since that time, can anyone guess how much food we've distributed? Over 200,000 pounds of food.
Oh, yes.
That is 105 tons of food. And that's only since 2015. Our food bank records, as we found out, actually started in 2015. So between 2015 and now, we've given away over 100 tons of food. So if we think that's about halfway between the amount of time we've actually run this program, that means we're closing on 500,000 pounds of food. Over 200 tons of food. That's amazing. So we'd like to quickly acknowledge and recognize some of the people who've made this possible. If you have ever volunteered even one day, would you please stand up? The food ministry program. Stay standing, please. If you've ever been a consumer and received food, would you please stand up? All right. So we started with Belinda and Bob White, then we moved to Judy Collins, Mike Collins, then we went to Bob and Crystal, and now we have Russ and Sharon running the program.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One of the things that Russ, Sharon, and I are looking at is what to do with this program. Where do we take it next? I challenged the board, my colleagues on the board of directors earlier this year. I said we can probably take this program even further. We serve people in how many counties? Take a guess.
Three.
You say three.
Three. Four.
Six counties.
Oh, wow.
Clinton County, Ingham County, Gratiot County, Shiawassee, Saginaw, and Genesee. So our geographical reach is pretty substantial. So one of the things I encourage us to look at is institutional donations, meaning donations from, could be companies, it could be restaurants, it could be foundations, could be charity. And I'm happy to announce today that we have been selected to receive a grant for Compassionate Ministry, $10,000. I sent an email to my best friend. His family has had some amazing success in life. And a few minutes later, they said they'd want to help us out. For a few days, I had no idea what that actually meant in terms of numbers. But yesterday, they confirmed that a check is being issued for $10,000. That will take our food budget past 2024 into 2025 at the current giving rate, possibly into 2026. So we are truly blessed.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Prayer of Thanksgiving. Amen. Blair, stay here. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are our provider. And Father, you have always come through in blessed ways. And we as a congregation gather before you humbly. And thank you for your provision. Thank you for those who have been so generous with us. Thank you for those who have the knowledge of how to find these things. Father, thank you for our congregation. And Father, we dedicate this to you. Father, we're asking that this generosity would bring many souls to you. Father, help us not just to feed their bellies. Father, help us. Help us to feed their souls, and may there be many souls won to you because of your generosity. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, Amen.
Oh, wow, I don't know.
That's a tough act to follow.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Allie has an announcement. Wow.
With Bob retiring from doing the One Call Ministry, we decided we wanted to give him a thank you. We've got a certificate and a card of thanks, and we'll be passing it around for you to put a little note into it, and we will get that sent out to him.
Yes, and we thank Bob for all the, how many years has he done this?
What have I got on the finger? I think it's seven.
7 years? 7 years. Let's give Bob a hand. Wow. My heart is full. How about yours? I don't think we need to go any farther. No. Not really. Anyway, our announcements, our CPR certification class will be October 21st from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. They had to change the date, and so
incidentally, the presenter was sick, and he just got back to work last Monday. He was really sick, so that's what caused the delay.
So change your date, October 21st, and it's in the bulletin there. If anybody needs to double check or anything like that,
talk with Lucy if you need clarification.
The next two Wednesday nights, there will be no Bible study on Wednesday nights. We're going to take a little time off, and when the cat's away, the mice will play. Yeah. So anyway, we're just going to take some time off here for a couple weeks. Our Operation Christmas Child, I see boxes are disappearing out there, things are coming in. Let's use the whole month of October to get your stuff in, to get all your things in. I want to have it all done by the end of October, everything in. so we can get those boxes packed, ready, and get it so we can take it over to Saginaw the middle of November. And so we want to have it all done by the end of October so we can be organized and get that off our plate and go on to something else. Okay, is there any other...
Hopefully you missed two announcements.
Did I?
Yeah, the ones in November.
Excuse me?
Oh, no, that's next week's full.
Oh, okay. Okay. Maybe you ought to leave.
I need
for
a vacation.
Like, you know.
Maybe tomorrow.
Yeah. By noon tomorrow. Yes. Anyway, is there any more announcements that need to be made at all? Anything I've missed on the bulletin? Okay. Any birthdays this week? Any anniversaries this week? Well, we're pretty quiet, aren't we?
October is a really
October.
Big month on birthdays and anniversaries.
October 8th, next week, next Sunday, is our potluck. Don't forget our potluck. And let's have our general missions offering this morning. Let's a couple ushers come forward and take that this morning. And Charlene, will you offer our prayer, please?
Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, as we just heard the good news about our food pantry ministry. Oh, what a blessing it is. But now, we don't know just where all this money goes, the hearts that are open to contribute to the missions. We don't know just where all the money goes, but if it goes to the same resources that our church has been blessed with, I just pray that it helps the ones that are in need around the world. God bless them all. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Pledges this morning. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
Amen. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for this time that we can come and worship in your house and we can gather together and we can blend together our beliefs and what we stand for, Lord. And may we get encouragement for one another to, when we depart, we can take it out into the world and be that light to shine. We ask it all in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's sing When We All Get to Heaven.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace.
Yeah.
Get to heaven. Amen. Boy, it's going to be just a... I wish I could just talk to somebody that's up there. And just, but the Bible said, we're going to walk streets of gold.
Amen.
Not going to be just the gold on our finger. You know, it's going to be streets it's of it.
Gold is pavement up there.
Yeah, pavement. Yeah.
It's the cheap stuff.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, well, think
oh,
about
down
it.
Here is the cheap
yeah,
stuff.
Down here we have asphalt,
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Up there they got gold.
Yeah, they got gold. Yeah. Cool. Isn't that cool? All right. I'll fly away. We're going to fly away?
That's right.
Some glad morning when this life is over.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning to give back just a part of what you've given to us, all the many blessings. We ask, Lord, that you take this money and bless it and give us wisdom in how you would like us to use it to spread your name throughout the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. To say that Fauna is having her biopsy and possible surgery Friday. Be in prayer for her. She is in a lot of pain. And this is going to be an exciting week, maybe, to get her to Friday so that we can get some relief for her. Yes, Diana. Good to have you in the service this morning.
I want to ask for prayer for my oldest son, Bill.
Put that up to your mouth, please. Thank you.
He's been in the military quite a few years now and has worked another job. Well, as the last part of his military career, he has to go to Germany for 6 months. And Mama's not happy. That's too far away. But please pray for his safety while he's over there, because he's in the group that is medical care.
Yep.
So,
yep.
Thank you.
I've been there before with a mama's heart in military. And it, you know, all we have to do is hang on to the Lord, but some days. Yeah. Yes. Lisa.
I just want to thank God that I've been able to be a part of taking the trailer over to get food for the church. Without the experience that I had from truck driving, I wouldn't have been able to do that.
That's awesome, Lisa, and we thank you for doing that. We thank you for that. Anyone? Yes, Janie. Hang on. Put it right up to your mouth, honey.
Yes, ma'am. Well, I'll start with my concerns. She knows Michael's not here with me, and he has some kind of virus infection. I told him it's best he stay home with that.
Yes.
But he is very, very sick.
All right.
Also, I have a concern with my big toe on my right foot. It's very swollen and very red. So I'd like prayers that will soon disappear.
Sure.
Because this is the only pair of shoes I have, and if it gets cold, I'm going to be in major trouble because I can't wear socks with it because it hurts too much. Now, for praises, I received a beautiful bouquet of flowers. I had a little fun with it, though. Well, it said with love, and of course, it was from the church. I didn't tell my friend that, and I didn't realize what the consequences of not doing that, and I did afterwards, but that's okay. Everything will be fine, and I praise God for all his guidance and care.
Yes.
For bringing me back so far. Yes. From where I was at.
Yes, amen.
You know, it's been quite a journey, but I know who was with me all the way.
That's right.
And I'm very thankful for that.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Janie. Anybody else? Yes, Amanda.
I just wanted to let everybody know, with a sad heart, that I let everybody know that Kathy Clapp passed away this week. There's nothing luckily. I'm just saying thank you for the prayers for her, and please keep her family in prayer. This is going to be a tough time, and they are going to close Bryant School down. They didn't have enough subs. I'm sure it's going to be throughout the school. It's going to be crazy, but they did. They weren't going to because Wednesday's count day, but it's what they thought, they better do it. So they, all those people get to go to the funeral, so that's a wonderful thing. So thank you.
Oh, it's down, closed down for the funeral.
For the funeral.
Okay.
The
all right.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Anyone else? Yes, Pastor.
You've got Sharon back there first, if you would, please.
Sharon.
Talked to Carl Wolf yesterday. Marilyn is holding her own. They're trying to get the fluid out of her body. She's getting weaker all the time. She's dealing with the COVID and all of the ramifications of that. So I told him I would bring it to the church and we would continue in prayer. Janet Brenner went home from hospital yesterday. Jeremy and Austin are still sick in the house. She still has the coughs going on, but we'll see how she holds up with the boys and them being sick in there. Yep. Carl is doing good, though. He's just sounds t- tired.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. I was just going to mention, I got a text from Michelle, Marilyn's daughter, saying that they're trying, that they held her in the hospital overnight and all. Same thing Sharon said. Thank you. Oh, yes, that was the other one. On the way to church, Colleen, Colleen Cole texted us, and they are in the process of trying to move Carl from Hazel Finley over to Pleasant View. And but she was saying the day that Carl wasn't with it, right? Isn't that what she said?
No, she said that the wing that Carl is on,
that was it.
Like Carl tested negative, he does not have COVID. But Colleen has been sick with a cold and cough, and would like to put it.
Thank you.
Okay, let us stand and let's sing our prayer chorus. I cast all our cares upon you, Lord. We cast them all this morning. We've been braised, we have praises this morning, and we have cares. Let's put them on the Lord's shoulders.
I cast all my cares upon you.
Heavenly Father, as we gather this morning, Lord, you've already blessed us, and we just want to thank you and praise you for your provision. Lord, then too, as we come before you, thanking you for the beauty of the fall. Thank you for the way that you've walked with us, and as we come before you this morning, our hearts are really just kind of full with all of the things that you have for us. Lord, you've heard our praises, and we just appreciate it. And then, Father, though, you see our concerns, so many depending on us. Father, those that are so desperately sick, we think of Marilyn and Janet. Father, all we know how to pray for them is that your will would be done in their bodies. We pray that you'd be with the Clapp family in a special way. Lord, you know how she was so loved by her students, and this has touched us. We have our granddaughters, Amanda's children, all had her, and she was much loved. Pray that you would bring great comfort. Then, Father, we think of the other request. Here's Fauna, and so sick. And Lord, as we come before you again, we're just going to have to wrap all of these up in a bundle and say, won't you please have your will in their bodies. Father, control the pain. Don't let them suffer so much. Then, Lord, as we come before you too, we pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, whatever we may think about what's happening in our lives, it's minor compared to what they're going through. Lord, what they've asked us to do is to pray that they would be strong, and that they would suffer for you, that they would be full of love and so full of strength and love that their persecutors would see Jesus Christ and lay down their weapons and turn their hearts and lives to you. And we just lift that up. Father, you see our nation. Father, we just need a revival. We can play Ain't It Awful with just about every
center of power in our nation. But Lord, you're working something. You have a purpose and a plan, and we're trusting you. But what we're asking for is a revival, because we know if without a revival, our nation is done. And so, Father, will you bring us back to you? We don't want just a revival of religion that fills the church services. What we want is a revival that turns us back to one nation under God. Father, that's a religious statement, not a political statement. We just ask, please, please, save us. Father, we pray for those that are bound in sin. Father, here in our community, on our mission field, people are bound by alcohol and drugs, poverty. Father, all kinds of abuse, both the abuser and the victims. And Father, there's so much. And Lord, we're supposed to be here as your mission station. And we thank you for the outreach tools that you've given us. And Father, we're doing our best to plant seed. But Father, it needs to be watered, and it needs to grow to where it begins, where we begin to reap a great harvest. And so we're praying that the Lord of harvest would come and prosper and make the seeds bear much fruit. Be with our president, be with our governor, our legislators, our judges, our civil servants, all of them. Father, so many of them have even mocked you. We ask in a special way that you turn them to you. And Father, having been unable to turn them from you to you, Lord, move them out of their positions, please. We want to see them saved. But Father, our nation is more important than any one individual. We ask now that you'd be with our local area. Thank you for our leaders. We ask that you would be with them and that you would help them to be among the best and wisest among us. Thank you for our church. Father, thank you that you bless us so much. Father, as we come before you now, we do pray that you'd be with the remainder of the service. May everything that's said and sung and done be to your name's honor and glory. For we've asked it in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Our weekly proverb comes from James chapter 2, verses 18 and 19. Now, someone may argue, some people have faith, others have good deeds. But I say, how can you show me your faith if you don't have good deeds? I will show you my faith by my good deeds. You say you have faith, for you believe that there is one God. Good for you. Even the demons believe this, and they tremble in terror. May God bless this word. Just for kids. And then we're going to have a special music by Mark Laurie on the video, and he's going to bring us a special about old people. And I see our sermon is going to be about coping with the challenge of its aging. Now, none of us know that yet. There are challenges about aging. So listen up to Mark and Pastor this morning and see what he has to say. There's maybe something new in there that we don't know.
Okay, Kathleen.
Yes?
I'll meet you at the altar after service. You're in denial.
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm having fun.
What? Oh. You know something? The scripture says, the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Yes, amen.
And around here, we seem to have way too much fun. But I thank God. Have you ever been around grumpy people? Okay. It just makes life, but it's such a joy to be here. And I thank you. We're talking about aging and some of the fears, and I thought that maybe a good song for us to sing is Safe Am I. Safe am I, safe am I, in the hollow of His hand. Sheltered o'er, in His arms forevermore. No foe can harm me, no fear alarm me, for He keeps both day and night. Safe am I, safe am I, in the hollow of His hand. Amen. You folks all know that I live in Owosso, and I drive the roads. You almost can't get here now without driving the back roads. And we live in Michigan, and in Michigan, we tend to shoot deer with our automobiles. I have pastored this congregation now for 11 years, nearly 11 years in November. And as I drive those roads, the deer are just ever, but I regularly, if not always, say, Father, will You please protect me and protect my vehicle so that I don't hit a deer. We were going home from Bible study. We usually pick up Carol Bemis. Carol was sitting in the back seat. And as we're heading down Smith Road, all of the sudden, a deer jumped out, literally right in front of me. I slammed on the brakes, and we just missed the deer. And I mean, that kind of protection is wonderful. The only thing was, I discovered that Carol wasn't buckling her seatbelt. At which point, she flies forward and smacks my seat. Thank God for protecting her. She didn't break her glasses. She didn't break her nose. She did get a lecture. And now, every time we get in the car, I say to her, Carol, you buckled your seatbelt yet? You know. But I can tell you this. The summary of the story is this. I've been driving here back and forth for 11 years. And there have been lots of deers, lots of deer, lots of sighting, herds, three and four come across the street. We've had some close calls. But in 11 years, on a deer-infested roads around here, I've never, ever hit a deer. Can't say that for Lucy. Can't say it for Paula. But the Lord has blessed me. Now, I say that because when we start singing about Safe Am I, I want you to think about some of the fears that we have. And we need to ask our Father and realize that if we ask Him for protection, He will provide. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, remember, God loves you. Jesus loves you. This church really loves you, and so do I. Amen.
Wow.
they don't hurry, that's for sure. They get up early, though they don't have to anymore. They keep that old car shining, even if it's just a drive to the store or to that church they love, where they're the first ones through the door. Their babies are their babies, no matter how old they get. A stranger ain't a stranger, just a friend they ain't met yet. There's kindness, there's wisdom, and the heart of a child behind those wrinkles. Men I love.
Lucy.
Old people.
Sound. Oh.
She's got pictures, page after page. He's got stories and a pocket full of change. After all these years together, she's as beautiful as ever. That's what he'll say. And when you see one, you can bet the other ain't far away. Their babies are their babies, no matter how old they get. A stranger ain't a stranger, just a friend they ain't met yet. There's kindness, there's wisdom, and the heart of a child behind those wrinkles. Men I love, old people. The more I watch them, more like them. I wanna be less worried, more loved. Seems like they've got it figured out to me. Their babies are their babies, no matter how old they get. A stranger ain't a stranger, just a friend they ain't met yet. There's kindness, there's wisdom, and the heart of a child behind those wrinkles. Lord, I love.
We were on our way home from church 3-4 weeks ago, and that song came on. I had never heard it. And Lucy said to me, you know, for this series you're preaching, they might want to use that. But it is. I love old people. Most now because I am one, you know. I try and call my mom every Sunday night, usually do, and we always talk about a lot of things, but in the course of the conversation, almost every time, there's a report on our health. And when we get done with it, mom kind of sighs and says, you know, growing old isn't for sissies. And I have to agree. But you know, the psalmist expresses his fears when he says to God, do not cast me away when I'm old. Do not forsake me when my strength is gone. And as we age, as seniors in a senior family, we're confronted with deteriorating bodies, changing roles in the family, unfamiliar technology, and scam artists and predators, just probably to name the top four. Okay? Well, when I say that, we want to talk about these things and confront them. And our text is taken from 2 Corinthians. Now, some background here is going to really help fill in some blanks on what Paul says. First of all, when Paul wrote 2 Corinthians, he was around 50 years old. And especially in that culture, their life expectancies weren't near what ours is. And around 50, Paul was aging. If you go to the 11th chapter of 2 Corinthians, verses 23 to 29, Paul goes and he shares the trials and the troubles that he has confronted over his life. He's talked about imprisonment, and he talks about beatings, and he talks about danger from bandits, from fellow Jews, from the Gentiles, from false believers. He was constantly confronted with those things. He talked about there were times when he was hungry. He didn't have any food. Talked about how he didn't have enough clothes to keep him warm. And he had going through that. Now, if we go to chapter 12, he talks about that the Lord gave him a thorn in the flesh. Now, that thorn in the flesh is probably some physical affliction. A lot of scholars speculate that his problem was that he was going blind. His eyesight was failing. And there's a couple references, passing references in Scripture that would tend to indicate that. But so he asked God, he said, God, please take this away. And God said, no. But Jesus walked the shores of Galilee and healed everybody. Yeah, but when we come to times of aging, God told him, no, my strength is made perfect in weakness. Paul said, therefore, I'll rejoice in my weakness that the glory may come of God. Next. Now, in the verses before our text, Paul is speaking about the hardships that he's had preaching the gospel. And in verse 11, he says this, for we who are alive, now notice he said we, not me, we who are alive, are always given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be revealed in our mortal bodies. Now, mortal bodies are bodies that are going to die. And he talks about that we're doing that. Now, when we, where am I here, Eric? So when we get to our text, so we have Paul somewhere around 50, growing older, coping with a deteriorating body and problems in the family. And what I want you to notice as we read this text, I want you to catch his attitude and I want you to catch his focus, okay? Therefore, we do not lose heart. After all this that I rehearsed before you, and he says, oh, hey, life's a bowl of cherries, and somebody else got the pits, you know? Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away. I like the way he talks about that, wasting away. Yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. Now we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling. Because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up in life. Now, it's God who has made us for this very purpose and has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. I'll just have to be blunt. I find it almost hard to do an exposition of looking at all the things that were going on in his life. And say, well, his opening statement is, we don't lose heart. And I'm thinking, I'm glad it's you and not me. Think about what was going on in his life. And he says, no, I don't lose heart. Well, how can he do this? First of all, he focuses on the renewal of his spirit. Day by day, he renewed, and not on his deteriorating body. We keep our eyes on a deteriorating body, and we are going to become hopeless and whatever. Therefore, we do not lose heart, though the outward body, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. Think about that. He does not deny the fact that his body is deteriorating. In fact, he uses some pretty graphic words saying, it's wasting away. Now, folks, please understand, Paul isn't an ostrich with his head in the sand. He is his feet are firmly planted, and he sees his body wasting away. He doesn't deny it, but he chooses not to look on the aches and the pains and the deterioration. He chooses to focus on the renewing of his spirit instead of his hurting body. Wow. You say, Pastor John, that's tough. Uh-huh. How do you know? I got a wasting away body. And I love what Ken Davis had to say. He said, you know, when I turned 50, I realize that when I wake up in the morning, somewhere there's some part of my body hurts. Okay? Yeah. But he chooses to focus on the spiritual. Second, he focuses on the rewards for his trials and not the pain of his trials. Notice what he calls his trials. For our light and momentary troubles. Paul, I read your list of your troubles, and I wouldn't call them light by any stretch of the imagination. And momentary, this has been going on your whole life. But he says, they're light and they're momentary. Why? They're achieving for us what? Eternal glory that outweighs them all. He's comparing. No, he's not denying, again, we said, he's not denying that these aren't tough, but when he takes the long view and he sees what's going to be the reward for having gone through the trials, lived for Jesus, exercised his faith, prayed for doing those things, he looks ahead and he said, these things are really light and momentary compared to the eternal glory. That is, and all of that outweighs them all. It has to do with a long-range view. It has to do with looking beyond here and looking into the hereafter. So he, excuse me, bring that back, Eric. So we fix our eyes on what is unseen. Now notice the idea of fixing our eyes on the unseen means that that's where we focus. We're going to focus on the unseen. He focuses on the unseen and the eternal. This allows him to call his trials light and momentary. And where we focus our attention determines how we handle our aging. I like what Abraham Lincoln said. People are about as happy as they want to be. What's that mean? It depends on where you're going to focus your attention. Where are you going to focus your attention? Next, he looks forward to his new body. He calls this body a tent. Temporary. I want you to get the picture. Suppose that we're living here and we're hard times have happened and we're living in a tent, right? That is really temporary. But our new body is a house that God makes for us that's eternal. And the idea here is calling this a tent. It's temporary. And as we get older, it starts to get holes in it. And it begins to kind of shake. And maybe it doesn't hold the water out the way it used to do. You know what I mean? But we've got this tent that we're living in. It's temporary. Never was intended to be our final place. But it looks ahead. And he says, you know something? We've got a house that's not made by humans. It's not made by man. It's made by God. Now, I can tell you, we've got some mighty nice contractors around here. And they build some beautiful homes. But they can't come close to the home that God's building for us, right? And that eternal body that we have is not going to ache. Well, I don't know how to handle that. You can breathe. You folks all know that I've got asthma, and I can tell you, I went to the doctor here last week, and I was, first time in my life, he says, you've got severe COPD. Now, I can focus on that, but when I get to heaven, I can breathe. Yay! Okay. What do you want to focus on? New body? Or focus on how tough it is with these. But when he gets to the end, he reaches this absolute crescendo when he talks about this new house. And he says that at this point, this mortal, this temporary thing, this mortal is going to be swallowed up with life. Folks, I've had to preach 2 funerals in 2 weeks. And they always hurt. And I'll be honest with you, I'm looking forward to heaven. And I don't know if I'll be pastoring up there. I doubt it. But if I'm pastoring up there, I'll thank God I don't have to preach funerals anymore. I'm tired of death. I'm tired of separation. Sure, I always point people to the hope that we're in a better place and we'll soon be there and want to be an unbroken family around the circle of God. But I'm tired of preaching in hope. I want to live it. And what he's talking about is his focus is not on this mortal. His focus is that this mortal death-ridden body is going to be, I love the term, swallowed up by life. Amen? Amen. Now, and finally, in that text, he points out that God gave us the Holy Spirit, right? We're Christians, filled with the Spirit, all those kind of things. What he points out is that this Spirit that God gave us is a deposit that guarantees what he's been promising about there. It's the guarantee. It's the down payment. It's coming. You got the down payment. Just hang on to it because it's coming. You got this to prove to it. Yeah, it's on the way. Amen? Amazing. Amazing. Now, Paul was able to age well because of where he focused his attention. You see that? Well, let's talk about dealing with aging. Let's start with our deteriorating bodies. First of all, don't deny it. If you could go in and deal, I don't have time to pick up those scriptures. You might want to go back and read them yourselves. But he talks about in one place where he says, we groan. You get up in the morning and instead of saying, good morning, Lord, you say, oh, good Lord, it's morning. Oh. Okay. But what he focused on was not the deterioration, but on being renewed. Now notice how the renewal comes. Day by day. This isn't something that we can go to church, get a shot, go to a convention, get all inspired, and it's going to be okay. No, this is something that's a daily discipline, okay? Time in prayer, time in the Word. Oh, you're talking hours, Pastor John. No, I'm not. I'm talking about maybe reading a chapter a day. In my morning Bible study, in my morning Bible reading, I read one chapter. It takes me less than 5 minutes. And then I ask the Lord to teach me to pray, and sometimes I pray for 5 minutes, and sometimes I pray for an hour. But it's that daily coming into the contact with the Lord that renews us and strengthens us. Look forward to your new body. Say, well, this ain't much, but you ought to see the Lamborghini I'm going to get. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, you think this body is beautiful? Wow, wait till you see the way God makes it beautiful. Okay? We look forward to our new body. Second thing that we have to deal with, and unfortunately we don't talk about it much, but it's real, is our changing roles. To put it succinctly, we are the parents of the child. But as we age and our body deteriorates, that role switches. And while we took care of the children, now the children take care of us. Okay? I've pastored for over 30 years, and some of the most difficult problems that children have is because mom or dad simply will not accept that they can't do what they used to do. Okay? Next one. Swallow your pride. It takes humility to admit that the old gray mare ain't what she used to be. Okay? A lot of it is just stinking pride. However, we want to hang on to our independence as long as we can, right? We do. We need to do that. But there is a difference between being independent and being controlling. And too often what we're trying to do is control everything around us, and we're really not able to. And all we end up doing is creating problems in the family. Technology. Let us pray. Eric. Use what you need, not what Verizon or Apple tell you that you need. Okay? That's wisdom. Every time you get a new device, whether it's a new phone or anything, there is a learning curve. I had to get a new phone. I've managed to hang on to my sanctification by a thread. Thank God, you know, for communication and stuff. By the way, I want to mention to you that I am having problems with my phone. And sometimes when you call me or I call you, my calls break up. It lasts for about 30 seconds. Don't hang up. Hang in there. I'll get to you eventually. Now, I got to live with that. I have spent a day and a half trying to straighten it out, down with Verizon, on the phone with Verizon. If that doesn't test your sanctification, nothing will. And still trying, and it's still not right. Okay? It gets pretty bad when the people at the technology center at the Verizon Center can't fix it. Okay? Now, there's a learning curve with everyone. So, what you want to do is use what you need, not what Verizon or Apple tell you you need. You probably don't need an iPhone 15 unless you love to take pictures and unless you're one of those techies that just has to have the newest kind and you get a thrill out of going up that learning curve. God bless you. But for 99% of us, we're not in that crowd, okay? Use what you need. Second thing, be honest with your kids. Ah, Mom, look, this is a great phone. And you can do this, and you can do this, and this is, and besides that, you can stay in contact with us doing. At which point, seeing all that, your eyes glaze over. Now look, be honest with your kids. That's what you want to do. I won't tell that. Most of the homes that I know, and I know people sitting here, have to regularly go and fix their parents' phone. And the TV, right? And they have to do it. But, and children do it graciously, do it gratefully, and say, ah, Mom, it happens, you know. But we need to recognize something. As we get older, we have learned what we need, how we need to communicate, and that we don't need a lot of bells and whistles. Paul, writing to Timothy, said, those that desire to be rich fall into many foolish and hurtful lusts. And I'm thinking, those who wish to be technologically advanced fall into many foolish and hurtful problems. You know? But you've got to be honest with your kids. Don't try and hide it, but be gracious about it too. Thank them for what they're trying to do. But just admit, I've reached an age that I have trouble grasping this and go through it. The last thing I want to deal with is because it is something that is focused. The main focus of scams and predators are older people. Okay? The younger people tend to be more technologically advanced than we are. But we are used to we're used to being able to trust, and they don't. Okay? And for good reasons. First of all, if you get something that seems too good to be true, it's not true. It's been, 6 weeks ago or so? I'm on the internet. All of you know that I frequent Harbor Freight the way Lucy frequents Bed Bath & Beyond. And I got this ad from Harbor Freight that says, hey, there's this $30 thing for $8.99 and you can get it. All you got to do, but you got to get it now. Well, I was in my study and trying to clear things. I'll get that. And so I ordered it. And after I did it, I thought, oh, no. I went back and I checked the to list and they had all the Harbor Freight logos and everything, and it certainly looked like Harbor Freight, but who it was from was from, how did you do that? So what did I have to do? Because I did that, I had to cancel my debit card and get a new one and go through all of that. Okay? When you get these ads, and they're getting really slick at making them look like they're from the company, but if it's too good to be true, and since then I've gotten two or three letters from Harbor Freight saying, be careful, this is going on, we've got our security team trying to stop it, but you've got to be careful, okay? So if it's too good to be true, it's not true. Second thing, you're going to get phone calls. And these phone calls come in two varieties. One variety is they're imitating a relative saying, hey, I'm in trouble. They'll often talk about being in jail, or they're talking about needing tires or something. They're going to say, I need it and I've got to have the money right now. Could you go down and send X number of dollars? And it's usually at least four figures. Or they'll say, would you get a gift card and go do that and send it? Scams, okay? And they're saying, I gotta have it right now. And if there's pressure to take it right now, tell them, this is a scam, you're stealing from people and you're gonna go to hell if you don't repent. I'm serious. These people need the gospel. Okay? No. What? And a jail cell. Keep preaching, sister. The other kind comes from a phone call. The other day, was it yesterday or Thursday? I got a phone call, and this voice on the other end says, hello, my name is XYZ, and I'm wondering, have you received your new Medicaid card yet? And I said to her, this is nothing but a scam. Goodbye. Now, you'll get different kinds of calls like that. Now, why are you saying this, Pastor John? I've already confessed to you that I've been caught on it, and I'm probably one of the more technically savvy people among us. Yeah. Now, you don't have to tell that. But by that same token, so we've got to be careful. And what's going to happen, and here's the thing, when it always happens real quick, and a lot of pressure to get it done quick, and you've got to slow it down and stop. Okay? Chuck.
A little info, if you go to FCC, call them and sign up for a scam-free video.
Yeah.
It will stop those phone calls right now.
Yeah. Yeah, it's... I forget what the program they call, but yes, there are things out there to stop those. Okay, so that's where we are. Well, let's land. What we've talked about today is that growing old is not for sissies. We laugh, but deep in our hearts, we know it's not true. Or we know that it is true. We don't deny the pain of our problems. We don't deny. Whether it's in our body, in our family, in trying to live, trying to do, we don't deny it. But if we focus on what is seen and felt, we'll be grumpy and hard to live with. Okay. If we experience a daily spiritual renewal, focus on our new body, the unseen and the eternal, we will be gracious, wise, old people who have a smile on our face and a twinkle in her eye. Before the aging process set in on me, as a pastor, I've visited many older people. And I determined, God, when I get to the point that I can't, you know, do what I used to do, will you help me to be a happy old man that people like to be around? I don't want to be a grump. Help me, Father, to focus on you and not on me. Let us pray. Father, you have led me to preach this series, and you know that this one for me has been one of the more difficult sermons to preach. I love these people. But Lord, I also have watched them too. As far as I can tell, there isn't a grumpy one among us. And I thank you. Lord, as we've just spent some time around your table and let you talk to us about this aging process and how that we can be people that in our old age are loved, Lord, help us to be like Paul and focus on the unseen, the eternal, and the rewards, and not on our pain. In Jesus' name, amen. It's the first Sunday of the month, and it's time for communion. Can I have the ushers come forward, please? On the night he was betrayed, the Lord took bread and he blessed it. Did you get that? He blessed the bread. And the reason that there is a blessing on the bread is so that everyone shares in that blessing. Okay? He blessed the bread, he broke it, and he said, This is my body, which is for you. As often as you eat this bread, do it in remembrance of me. Father, as I bless the bread today, I ask that you would bless us, that as we do it in remembrance of you, what we remember is the hope and the glory and the joy that awaits us when we either pass away or join you at the resurrection. Please, Father, help, bless us with spiritual eyes that are renewed day by day. Then he took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant in my name. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." When we start talking about covenant, we're talking about that formal relationship between us and our Savior. Most of us have been saved a long time. And when we first got saved, it was all, you know, "Lord, I give you all." But in the trials and the things that have come, sometimes all was quite hard. And whatever all is, it's a whole lot bigger than it was when we accepted the Lord as our Lord and Savior. But as we drink the cup, let us remember that it was blood shed for this relationship that we have between Him, and that we take this relationship and say, "Father, I want to renew my covenant with you again. And I want you to know that no matter what all is, what it is now, or what it will be in the future, all is still all. And I love you." Father, as we bless the cup, would you let this time be a time of rededication for us, and that we renew our experience with you. And that, Father, as we take the bread and we take the cup, Lord, will you help us to see through the veil into eternity and give us such joy that even though our outward man is withering away, our inner man is renewed day by day. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. He took the bread, he broke it, and he blessed it, and he said, "This is my body broken for you. As often as you take it, do it in remembrance of me." He took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "This is the new covenant in my name. This is the blood of the new covenant in my name. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." Let us stand.
Until the day.
Teresa.
Father God, we just thank you for this day and for the wonderful weather. We ask that you dismiss us from this assembly, but not from your presence. Keep our eyes on you and joy in our hearts. We just ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As you go this week, may you find yourself renewed in the inner person. And as you find yourself renewed, you'll find yourself full of joy. Go share the joy. Amen? Amen. Go in peace.